So friends, this is the seventh lecture in the series that we have, and we have been growing over a period of time, and it's nice to have so many experts from around the globe be participants and be partnering us for this lecture series. We are getting a good response from students all around the globe, and participants are coming over to attend our series. So that's a heartening factor. That means something good we are doing, and students are liking it. Dr. Puva, thanks for agreeing to be part of this particular lecture series today. And participants, you all will be hearing him later after a couple of minutes. Well, today's theme that we have is sustainability and tourist gaze. I've made some improvisations today. One very important aspect that I was thinking, because I'm getting so many emails from my participants also of this series and other students also, that we need to know what is going on vis-a-vis COVID-19 is going on, vis-a-vis tourism and hospitality is going on, vis-a-vis other things are going on. So we need to know about it. And I'm getting so many mails with the information about what is going around in tourism and hospitality industry, especially from the UNWTO and from Center for Excellence in Destination, CED. As you all are aware, I'm the regional director for Asia and Eastern Europe. So I'm handling the World Center of Excellence in Destination. So they have been sending a lot of information around, and I'm getting a lot of things from their blog and etc. So I thought that why not make a change today? And from today, the first slide that I'm going to show is going to be the updates that has happened since our last lecture to this day. So today, since it's a Wednesday today, so our last lecture was on Saturday. So between Saturday and today, whatever changes, because you all are aware of the fact that the changes are happening at a very fast pace around the globe. The ministers, the prime ministers, the head of institutions are coming on board and announcing different things as and when they learn about it, as and when they are learning about it. So that's a very important aspect, and that's what I wanted to refer to. So I'm going to give spare some time for the updates also, where you can see these updates and what is going on actually and what is going on over around the globe. So what has happened within past 3-4 days. So this is these are the updates which I've taken from UNWTO website and their various literature that they have been circulating. So these are the updates that I've got from there. So you all being from hospitality and tourism industry should be aware of these updates. And this is going to be a regular feature now. In every lecture that's coming Saturday, so what has happened in past 2-3 days. So we should inform the students that what is going on and what is building it up. So there's a technical assistance package for tourism recovery being launched by UNWTO. So that's an heartening thing. A lot of you are worried about placements and all those things, and you should be aware of the fact that the Apex institution around in the globe is working on building up a technical assistance package, and this is devoted towards tourism recovery. And this package primarily is structured around three very important things: economic recovery, marketing and promotion, institutional strengthening, and resilience building. Resilience building. Now, this is a very important aspect. When I was looking at it, I felt happy also. If the participants who have been with us since first lecture, they must be aware of the fact that I've been talking about two very important things in every lecture. One has been resilience and another has been flexibility. So here is one of the points that I referred around 1 month back is now there in the UNWTO report also. So resilience building is going to be a very, very important aspect, and you all have to take a look at it. I'm going to talk about it a little bit in the end also today about resilience building, because I'm happy that at least whatever we are talking about, people are listening towards and trying to add, and other people are also thinking alike. They want to support, designed to support governments, the private sector, donor agencies, whatever the socio-economic emergencies has. So the UNWTO is trying to build up an assistance package. Now, this is a very drastic thing. International tourist arrivals could decline by 60 to 80%. That's a huge, huge number. And last time when I was talking to you, 95% of the countries had imposed the travel lockdown. At this moment, 100% of the countries have imposed travel lockdown, international travel lockdown. That's a big thing. Decline in export revenues, these figures are huge, like 910 billion to 1.2 trillion. 100 to 120 million jobs are directly at risk. So a lot of things are going on. Technical assistance package might look towards working towards it, might look towards building it up. But these are the updates which you all should have, and all the tourism and hospitality students should have, teachers, stakeholders should have on hand. So this is something which I'm going to keep sharing with you before I start every lecture of mine from now onwards. Now we come to the sustainability aspect. So what are we trying to talk about? We're talking about our natural and social resources. See, sustainability can be defined in one very simple line. We usually talk about sustainability vis-a-vis climate is concerned, or living things are concerned, or our environment is concerned. But sustainability can be classified into very, very simple words. Something, whatever you have acquired in your life, leaving it in the same manner, if not in a better shape. What I mean to say is, you enter a classroom, the chairs, the desks, everything in the classroom is in a particular order. When you leave the classroom, they should be at least in the same order in which you acquired, if not in a better shape. So whatever you acquire in your lives, leave it in as it is as you acquired. Be it the air that we breathe, be it the water that we have, be it whatever resources or social resources or cultural resources that we acquire, if not in a better manner, make an effort to make them better. But if you cannot, at least leave them. And if we all do this part, I think sustainability is going to be the in thing. Well, preservation and maintenance of the status quo, that's what I've been talking about, has to be there, if not in a better manner. But one very key important aspect that we have been talking about, we talked about in one of our earlier lectures also, I think second or third lecture, where me and Dr. Kandappan were discussing about the technology and innovation aspect, that we all need to innovate, we all need to redevelop, redesign, we all need to invent things. And when we try to innovate, obviously there are certain disruptions being created. There has to be a trade-off between the sustainability and technological development. Now, while technological development might harm some aspects of sustainability, we have to see to it that it doesn't do that. So that is a very, very important aspect. We try to innovate vis-a-vis our economic or our financial sustainability is concerned, social, environmental value systems are concerned. We try to build them. We try to preserve them. We try to see to it that technology components or technology interventions are brought into it, but in line with the principles of sustainable development goals. That's a very important aspect. GACE. Now, what actually we are referring towards over here vis-a-vis GACE is concerned. We are actually looking at a presupposition of social activities, science, which locate the particular tourist practices. Now, what we are looking at over here is that if you want me to sum it up, it will be something laying a lot of stress on the visual aspects that we have, visual aspects as a tourist that we see rather than the whole experience. Now, this is also something, a terminology which was used by John Urey decades back. And now we are looking at more towards experiential marketing, experiential things. But with the times that are coming now, with the way the COVID is progressing now, and with the way the protocols are being built up and normals are coming out, that you don't need to travel, you don't need to go abroad, you don't need to go to other destinations. So what is going to, the visual aspects are going to play a huge role, because we can create videos, we can create a lot of visual content, video content, online content, which can actually, inspire the tourists, and which can also keep them motivated. And in future, they would like to visit these particular things. There are some types of criteria for the sustainability indicators that we look at. You all should be aware of these particular things. So this is something which I wanted to explain over here. There are three prime issues that we keep talking about. One is environment, one is social, and one is economic. So whenever we are talking about sustainability performance, we're talking on these three issues that we have. And the indicators for environment could be land, forest, water, air, waste management, biodiversity. So land, when we are trying to talk about that, how much land is being eroded, or afforestation or deforestation is happening on how much area, that's a very important place. What is the quantity and quality of water available, how things are moving up, what are the carbon emission norms that we have, how the waste is being treated, that's a very important aspect. Obviously, we cannot stop people from creating waste. We cannot stop institutions, the hotels and other institutions, from creating waste, but how that waste is being treated, how that waste is being used, that's a very, very important aspect. Issue vis-a-vis social issue that is concerned, we have poverty, population literacy, efficient and clean energy, law and order. Now, when we try to talk about literacy is a very, very important indicator and a very important component. The more educated the people are, the better they understand, the better civilized, in a civilized manner they behave, the more they try to make the tourists comfortable, and more they follow in sync or in synchronization with the guidelines of the UNWTO or the Ministry of Tourism or the TMCs or the DMOs, the more they follow those guidelines, the better the situation is. And obviously, we're looking at some economic aspects where we try to talk about the employment and income and what is the unemployment rate and what is the income that we are looking at. Some of the warning indicators that I want to brush up over here is regarding that we are having certain tricky sustainability issues. We are having certain problems is, for example, a pressure or stress on, for example, we have stress on our demography, that is population growth is going on in a big way. There is a lot of stress on the natural resource base that we have, biological and physical impacts that we are finding on. Finding over cultural and economic impacts, how culture of a particular region, particular area, particular site, particular destination is eroding, and how things are moving at a very fast pace. How economic activity, whether there are going on large amount of economic leakages, or whether what we have is that people are able to retain, or the local population is earning a lot because of that touristic activity. Well, these are the four things that we need to look at, how we need to grow the sustainable development. We need to, first of all, our stakeholders have to work towards social sustainability, political sustainability, financial sustainability, and cultural sustainability. The social order should be correct, should be properly taken care of. Financial sustainability, minimal amount of leakages have to be there. So that is very important. Yesterday, our Prime Minister was talking about being vocal for local. So he said that we have to be very vocal vis-a-vis local is concerned. That means whatever amount of things that we are procuring, obviously they should be locally manufactured, but locally also people should benefit out of it. That means the local economy, the majority of the money should pump into the local economy so that the people are able to build up or able to earn out of it. All for action that I have over here is that is economic, promotional, institutional measures that I'm looking at. That we have to respect the socio-cultural authenticity of the host communities. We as the DMOs or as TMCs, as well as the tourists, we have to take care of the fact that people working with us, all the stakeholders, try to see to it that the social-cultural authenticity of the host community is taken into account, and not much pilferages are done into that. We need long-term economic operations. In my earlier lectures, I was talking about the fact that domestic tourism is going to be which is going to pick up, and domestic tourism also within the range of 100, 200 kilometers is going to be very important. And I also stressed upon a very important fact, which is going to be a locked up economic operations or is going to ensure viability, is that the tourism companies, which are primarily promoted by MSMEs or small companies, that they are the ones which are actually going to help us survive and actually help us building up sustainability within that particular region. These are some of the key success factors that I've designed over here, that I've mentioned over here. Green programs, renewable energy sources, waste management, which I already spoke about. I think I've taken a lot of time from my own side, but this is something which I would like to tell you. Flexibility again will be the key. Resilience, which I was trying to take care of, that resilience, self-care, team care, and workplace care. This is going to be very important for hospitality and tourism people. We have to see to it. For example, now the airlines industry is trying to come up. They are trying to start their operations. Roadways, railways is going to start their operation. Workplace care is going to be very, very important for those people. Thank you. Thanks a lot. That was something from my end. Now I would request Dr. Puva to start his lecture.
Thank you, Prof. Parikshat. First of all, thanks for inviting Taylors and myself, okay, to be a part of this particular initiative. I can see that we have participants from India, Malaysia, Philippines, anybody else? Anywhere else?
I think we have some from Egypt also, and okay. Pakistan also.
Okay. We have a good diverse group. So let me share my screen first. Prof, you got to allow me to share my screen. I made you host ready. Can you? Okay.
I've done it.
Now I can, yes. Okay, I'm sure you can see the screen.
Okay.
I will try not to consume a lot of time of this session and talking so that we have more time for discussion. Okay, and I will try to explain the relationship between sustainability, tourist gaze, and also COVID-19. Which is the contemporary issue. Okay. I think as introduced by the moderator earlier, my research mainly is in the rural areas of Malaysia. Okay. So the main reason is because of the sustainability issue itself. As a strong believer of sustainability, as Prof. Prakshat mentioned just now, the order should be right. By social or socio-cultural dimension should be leading the whole sustainability spectrum. You will see in a while. Just a quick conclusion or quick summary of what is happening now. As Prof. Parikshat said, that we have some latest data now. You know, the first data which was released by UNWTO was 23rd or 25th of March, okay, which was saying that we are on a 39% reduction of tourist arrival. 39% reduction. Meaning, if your country is expecting 10 tourists for this year, okay, 39%, close to four of them are not coming. Only 6 tourists will reach your country. Okay, you're going to have only 6 tourists in this particular year. And of course, we through a lot of webinars, a lot of arguments were done. We were so skeptical with this data, and the latest one reflects the real scenario. Okay, close to almost double the figure, which was for released the first data. It's close to 78% tourist arrival decline. Now you will see this year, even in Q1, if you can see Asia, the worst hit region. Which negative 35%. And as I mentioned earlier, the worst case scenario in December, by December, we will be able to see scenario 3 is the worst case scenario. The orange color dotted points and the blue color. Okay, this is the best recovery route, let's say. Earlier in July, let's say we recover, we can open our borders in July itself, so we might see 58% reduction. Almost half of the tourists are gone. But worst case scenario, 78% is quite bad for the whole industry. Okay. Now back to sustainability, the core theme of the lecture today. Okay. So what is sustainability? Prof. Parikshat well explained just now. So I don't have a lot of problem to explain this. Okay, it's the ability. Okay, it's the ability or capacity to consume the resources of the earth. Okay, without making it a problem to the future generation. That is sustainability. You can take things from the earth. You can, you can do tourism. Okay, you can clear a particular area. You can set up. You can establish a resort, but make sure. Okay, you preserve the environment. You do something else, right? For the destructions that you have made. Okay, so if you see why we need to preserve, why we need to save, why we cannot be so greedy to be highly developed. It's not that we don't want development, but you cannot be so greedy. Mainly because of the world population. Population is growing. The resources are same. Okay, resources are scarce, right? So you need to plan properly in a very much well-balanced manner. So there are three main pillars of sustainability: economic, social development, environmental dimension. Okay, so mostly, okay, we are focused in economic. If you see even the literature of sustainability, even before 1980s, right, heavily influenced tourism economy. Okay, then slowly the social environmental dimensions came in. Okay, all started a little bit of a background of sustainability. It's not new. Sustainability is not new. However, sustainable development concept, somebody was asking in the chat room just now, what is the model? Okay, it is basically from Brundtland. Okay, Dr. Jo Brundtland, a Norwegian president. She also received an award from India, Indira Gandhi Award, I believe it's in 1992, if I'm not mistaken, 92 or 93, you may want to check. Okay, so she went against, okay, the existing concept that particular time, basically the Western paradigm, saying that, okay, my country is so developed, okay, I have a lot of money, okay, I have a very good income from tourism, from my industries, so I am developed. So a group of scholars and policy makers, okay, mentioned that this is not right. We need to develop in a much more sustainable way. How about your environment and socio-cultural dimensions, right? When you can say that you have protected your environment, your society, your culture is well preserved, okay, then you are well developed. Then you are sustainable, okay? So the model was well established that time in order to have a well-balanced development. This is not for tourism only. This is overall sustainable development model. Later on, tourism employed this model as well. If you see, even in Malaysia, some of the policies, we include all three pillars to develop our policies. So soon after that, 1987, there were a few other arenas, platforms to discuss what are the right criteria, what are the right indicators. Okay, so yes, sustainability, economic, social, how do we measure? Okay, with the, in 2000, the year 2000 Millennial Summit, we had 8. Okay, then after that, we had the Rio Conference. Okay, and the one that is very famous that we know now is the 17 SDGs, Sustainable Development Goals. There are 17 goals. You may want to just recheck. These 17 goals actually are from the basic three dimensions which I showed you earlier: economic, social, culture, and environment. Okay, just like the order which was showed by Prof. Parikshit just now, I was very happy to see that he has stated socio-cultural as his first dimension. He is right. Look at goal number one: no poverty, no hunger, good health. Okay, quality education, gender equality, first, number 1 to 5, all related to social well-being of the people. So United Nations has realized the development is not going in a healthy manner. Global development. So we need to take care of the people first. If we go on developing rapidly, okay, we are reaching the end of the world. Just like if you watch the movie Avengers, Thanos would want to kill half of the population of the world, right? Because too many people, okay? Not enough resources, right? So that is already happening. So realizing that United Nations has developed from the core model of three dimensions, we have this now. The importance is given to the social aspect. Social out of three, economic, environment, and social, okay? Social aspect, whereby you can see it is evident that most of the goals are very much relevant to communities and social well-being. Okay, and why? First of all, why there was this sustainability concept developed? Okay, what is the need for sustainable development, sustainable tourism? Okay, now we are into tourism already. Basically, because of mass tourism. Okay. I won't say mass tourism is bad, fully giving us negative impacts. Okay, mass tourism clearly gives us job opportunity, you can see here. And income for our government, for MNCs, for companies, okay, tax for the government, local council, okay, and infrastructure development. If you see this particular picture, this is in this was in China, December, just before COVID-19. Don't worry, I visited this particular our research area in China. Right, this particular lady here, she's in the 60s. She was very happy. This is the first time in her life she got a house to stay. And why she can get this house from the government? Mainly because of presence of tourism. Government detected that there is strong tourism attraction in the particular village. This is a very rural area of China. Okay, now let's develop the facilities, the infrastructure for the people. Because of tourism, people get infrastructure. Okay. Although we get this many benefits, mass tourism means a lot of people going to the same destination, right? Mass tourism, big crowd. Destruction is being made to environment. If you can see the picture here, this is in Bali. Okay, I'm sure this is not only in Bali. Many of marine or beach destination, tourism destination in the world experiencing this. And there's this another picture. You can critically debate later if this is correct. This is pro-poor tourism. This lady here taking a selfie with these kids in the slum area. This is slum tourism or pro-poor tourism. It is questionable. Okay, the tour company doing this, the tour guy who's doing this, bringing in tourists to this area, is claiming that this is sustainable tourism. We are giving money to the local people. This tourist is going in there just for a picture. She's giving like $10 to the people, local people there. But imagine the socio psychological impact created by the tourist on the local kids, in the minds of the local kid, right? The children going to ask their parents later that, why can't you be like the tourist? Why are you so lazy? Why are you so poor? I wouldn't want to stay here. Where is your iPhone? Right? Look at the auntie's handbag. Why can't you be like that? So what type of values that we are importing, we are injecting in the minds of the local communities? These are the negative parts of mass tourism. So we need to understand, talking about mass tourism, we need to understand why this problem happened. Okay, who is shaping the world? Is it Donald Trump? Okay, is it tycoons? Is this the big companies shaping the industry? Is it Hilton, Marriott? Okay, we need to revisit tourist gaze, as Prof. Parikshat also mentioned just now. Professor John Urey, one of the most important theories of one of the most important theory in tourism academia. You may want to read this if you may want to cite this in your studies, right? Gaze means looking at something for a long period of time. I'm gazing at something. I like this. This girl is so beautiful. I'm just looking at her. I'm just gazing at her. That is gaze. So gaze studies say that tourists are just observing, seeing a particular image or a tour destination for a very long period of time, or mesmerized with the particular area. So how tourists view the destination is very important. When you know how tourists are observing a particular destination, you can plan your policies and products. Okay. So according to Tourist Gaze 1.0, okay, tourists just, if gaze is important for them, they just follow. They just follow the packages which were prepared by the operators. Right, in 1990s, you don't have much connection, you don't have much info of Eiffel Tower or Mumbai, I think Bombay at that time, right? I wouldn't know, I just book my trip through a particular tour agent, I just follow. 2.0, globalized world, I have a lot of info. I gaze through technology at that time, right? And the latest tourist gaze 3.0, I'm so bored with technology, YouTube, Hollywood movies. I don't want to see Washington, D.C. through Hollywood movies. I just want to go there. No? Why? Because of image again, right? Because of image again, okay? And I want to get authentic experience. That's the keyword now. This is the contemporary, these are the contemporary tourists now, okay? Tourists would want to experience they themselves. okay, authentic experience. I wouldn't want to, you know, see somebody else go. I wouldn't want to book through somebody else. I know where to go. When I reach US, I know where to go. These are the places I want to visit. Okay. And this also leads, evident, this also leads to Instagrammable spots. You can see there are so many Instagrammable spots. Okay. I will show you one in the end of my presentation. You don't mind waiting for a long period of time just to get a picture to post in your Instagram or social media, right? So tour operators are utilizing this. Local governments are utilizing this. And this leads to over-tourism. Same people going to the same destinations again and again. Okay. Academicians, I'm very sure Prof. Parikshad and other scholars here, you have also raised this issue. Now, we have also raised to the ministers, the policymakers, United Nations on this particular issue. Mainly because even if you see the, I can see the people from Philippines here, right? From the Philippines. Boracay was closed down for 6 months, right? And you can see like places like Venice with local population of 54,000. The so-called Venice, 54,000 only local population and 26 million tourist arrival. If I'm a local resident there, I wouldn't want, you know, this much, you know, this many people in my destination, in my area. Every day to send my kid to the school, I have to go through heavy traffic because I'm stuck in this tourism destination. Of course, I might get some money from there. I might get some income. I might open my stall there, my souvenir shop, right? But what is balanced development? Is this balanced development? No control. Barcelona, Machu Picchu, even in Malaysia, Langkawi. I'm very sure you guys know Langkawi, Langkawi Island in Malaysia. 94,000 population versus 4 million tourists last year. Okay? So when if I can bring you back to the sustainable model, sustainable development model, looking at these cases, economically, you are super strong, right? Economically, you're super strong. You are a giant. If you are in Venice, you are very rich. But socio-cultural environment, you are very, very poor. Is this balanced development? So, although we had this issue, can you guess this place? You may want to write in the chat group. You may want to just answer just like that. Picture number one, I will quickly go through. Time limitation. Venice, nobody there now. Paris Eiffel Tower, no one is there now. Langkawi, this picture here, Langkawi, no one is going there now. India Gate, right? Nobody is going there now. This is very rare. Used to have like thousands of people at the same time, simultaneously, these areas, right? Because of COVID-19, over-tourism is solved. Okay, now, what are the things can be done now, right? During this COVID period of time, sustainable measures, tour guides or even students. The students can learn, try to learn various languages or various courses online. This is a time. Very soon, borders or tourism industry is going to be reopened. It's not going to be very long, right? You can see some countries are already, I will show you some example. Hotels can do virtual training or multitasking. If an employee in a hotel currently in front office department now can learn to do housekeeping. F&B, this is the time, right? The hotel can save cost according to the off-peak period of time, right? Local communities can develop niche tourism. I mentioned to you the Instagrammable spots just now. This is an Instagrammable spot, this particular picture here when I was in Bali last year. We queued up about 5 hours. 5 hours to get this picture. But this picture is not really authentic. It was developed by the local people. They were very creative to get this picture. You need to wait for about 5 hours. 5 hours, solid 5 hours. We went there at about 7 a.m., 7 o'clock in the morning, right? We got this picture. I got this picture at about 12 noon. Okay, so you may want to check in Google. So you need to develop this kind of tourism, and this is a time for the local community. They have some buffer time. And government, of course, stimulus packages. I'm very sure even Prime Minister Modi announced something yesterday for the people of India, right? Stimulus packages are very important to make the industry survive. Already many hotels are closing down. Imagine the SMEs, the small players. So are you worried? Okay. Worst case scenario, as I mentioned, this is by UNWTO, we might see a loss of 1.1 billion tourists. It was projected about 1.6 billion tourists to for this particular year. Last year, we reached about 1.5 billion worldwide travelers. This year, let's say 1.6, out of 1.6, 1.1 billion tourists. You can deduct the numbers. And loss of 1.2 trillion USDs and 120 million direct tourism jobs at risk. These are only direct tourism jobs, you know. Tourism is an industry that we know that we have lots of part-timers, lots of temporary workers, lots of contract workers, right? And only 120 million jobs are at risk. These are all full-time employees. Imagine the rest. Okay, so it's a big phenomenon. It's a big issue. And you may want to also read this particular research using catastrophe story. This was after SARS by Mao. It depends on the recovery period and effective and efficient policy implementation by government. Right, the quicker you recover, the quicker you get the market, the faster you grow. If you see in this region, China is already okay. It's okay back, right? When I was talking to my student in China, I just called him yesterday. He said, "Sir, we don't have to wear masks. We can just go out just like that." So they are just like normal, right? But when you go to tourism spots, there are certain measures you have to follow. I will show you the pictures later. And history has taught us this is not the first time. Although this time is the worst, this is not the first time. World War One, World War Two, SARS, okay, MERS, in the Middle East, Ebola in Africa, recession 2003, 2009, 1997, terrorism, Bali bombing. There was also attack in Mumbai. Okay, so we will definitely bounce back. Okay, there was attack in Sri Lanka, massive shooting in New Zealand. Okay, you go and see after 1 month. Full occupancy in these areas. Okay, tourism is the most fragile industry. It's too fragile. However, it will also bounce back strongly after some time. It's very, very sensitive. It's a very sensitive industry, but no one can stop tourism. That's a known fact from the history. Only thing this time is very much unprecedented. It's a pandemic, very, very bad. Okay, but we will recover back. Some good news, I'm sure you might have read the health of the rivers, Yanganga, Yamuna rivers, tremendously improved, especially the absence of pilgrimage tourism. Okay, in Thailand, hundreds of elephants were released back to natural habitat. Why? No tourist going there. Tour companies, okay, are just surviving. They cannot feed this animal. They cannot feed elephant. So they have to release back this particular species to back to nature. This is good. This is good. Okay. This is good in sustainable tourism viewpoint. This is not so good for an economist. Okay. So you need to understand I'm going on a neutral ground. Okay. China. So I'm talking like Thanos now. If you watch Avengers, I'm a Thanos now. Right. So try to have a balanced development. Okay, China tourism is definitely reopened. I believe that the first one to open was Great Wall of China, which was like about 70 kilometers. It's very long. 75 kilometers of Great Wall of China was reopened. I think second week of April itself. And when you can expect us to recover? May, June, domestic tourism might boost. This is overall. This is overall. Some countries might be very much delayed. May, June, this is again by UNWTO. The latest report a few days back. Okay. July, September, more of domestic tourism. You gain the trust from the people. More people would want to travel. Some countries might open the borders. Iceland, I think yesterday announced to open borders. I was shocked to see that Iceland opened the borders. Okay. But I believe they might be very strict in allowing tourists to enter. Right. Slowly, 2021, we might go back to the routine tourism circle. And which continent? Middle East, right? To go first, because the number of cases, not many, right? Europe, Asia, you can see the numbers. You may want to visit UNWTO to go on this. As I mentioned, China reopened 1st May, okay, with some strict rules. 1st May to 5th May, 105 million travelers traveled in China. This shows that the tourists are waiting to travel. They are not scared, but they will take proper initiative, social distancing before they travel. And governments must play their role now. Okay. 105 million travelers is like close to 10% of their total population of 1.5 billion, right? This shows that the industry, the travelers are vibrant and dynamic. Phuket, Pattaya, okay, first week of May. And even Bali was Bali is scheduled to be reopened 15th May. Bali, okay, ahead of the national plan, the particular famous tourism destination. And this is, I think I've reached my last slide. This is in Shanghai. This is Disneyland in Shanghai. Is this going to be the new norm? Is this going to be the new normal, which is being propagated by various authorities around the world, right? So what is this is a country that this whole thing started. And look at the people now, right? They are back to business. It's just like normal. They have to travel. They will travel. They want to travel. So the industry can be successful. I mean, individual operators, hotels, students, researchers, or anyone, all the stakeholders. It's about your resilience. It's about our resilience, right? How good we can sustain, how good we can be responsible, can be a tourist, can a tourist be a responsible traveler, okay? Can a seller, can a tour operator, can be a responsible tour operator, okay? Government announced that only 5 tourists in a van, right? In a travel vehicle, in a tour vehicle. Only 5. I used to bring 10. I used to get more money. Do I follow government rules? Can I just add 2 more? Can I just bring 7 of them? Nobody is checking. I can bribe the authority. I can bribe the police guy, traffic police. If you are like that, this thing is not going to be ended. You are not going to do sustainable tourism. So we need a holistic, if you see SDG 17, we need a holistic partnership, goal number 17, SDG 17. So we need a paradigm shift in order to do sustainable or responsible tourism. So when we do tourism sustainable in a much more sustainable, responsible way, we can easily combat COVID. In this scenario, in this picture, if you can see, Disneyland Shanghai, normal occupancy rate, 80,000 visitors per day. But Chinese government announced only 1/3 of the particular number can enter this place in a day. So about 25,000-30,000 people only. Okay. So when you follow these rules, you can combat this issue. So whether we are ready, it's questionable. I leave it to you. I leave it to the audience participants to debate on this later. Are we ready to be a responsible or sustainable tourist? With that, I would like to thank all of you and please stay safe. Thank you. Over to you, Prof.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Dr. Poova. I think Nikhil must be having some questions for us.
Yes, sir. I have collated few questions on my Word profile, and allow me to please share that particular Word file with you.
Sure, sure. Go ahead. In the meantime, I would like to just apologize. We were not able to uplink on Facebook earlier when I was speaking, but finally, when I left it, we managed to. So Dr. Puva, your lecture was there live. So actually, I didn't do it properly to begin with, but now we have been able to get hold of it. But it's nice. We are recording this lecture, so we will share it with on the Facebook page, and we'll have our questions also. So the first question that we have is, what would be the benefit of creating local infrastructure in terms of tourism building in post-COVID? Doctor, would you like to take it?
You want me to answer this?
Yeah. Go ahead.
Okay. Thanks. So what would be the benefit of creating local infrastructure in terms of tourism building in post-COVID? You see, we have to see holistically, okay? That particular local community, when you talk about local infrastructure, we're talking about local community, right? So they might not experience a good social well-being. Social well-being means they might not have proper job employment, proper health well-being status in the particular region. So post-COVID has created a route for the government not to channel all the tourists to Agra, for an example. There is Taj Mahal there. All this while, India, okay, Taj Mahal is the image. Okay. And some other destinations, maybe even in Kashmir, several spots. So these particular spots are well developed. The people there are well equipped with local infrastructure. Let's say there is another particular destination in India, Unpolished Diamond. So this is the time the government can divert these tourists to this particular destination. So COVID has created, because let's say I want to go to Taj Mahal. No? I wouldn't want to go this year or next year to Taj Mahal. I know it's going to be crowded. It's not safe, especially with COVID issue. I know that, let's say in October, there is no virus anymore. But I wouldn't want to bring my family there. But I'm thinking still I want to go to India. So where do I go? I want to go to an unknown place where this particular place is not so crowded. So this is a time when for the government to rethink, find a new spot, develop, divert the tourist from Taj Mahal, Agra to another place. And this will create benefit to the so rural or unfortunate rural, you can combat rural poverty as well.
Yeah, very well said, Dr. Puva. And I would like to add something over here. Well, local infrastructure, whatever is created, is also not only going to be used by the locals. It's also going to be used by the tourists, and vice versa also. It's not going to be only used by the tourists. It's also going to be used by the locals. So if you come up with a good healthcare system, if you are an adventure tourist site, and if you come up with a good healthcare system within that particular region, obviously, healthcare of the locals is also going to improve. It's not going to be that only adventure tourists are going to be treated in that healthcare system. If we have a wellness center, for example, in Vaishno Devi, Mata Vaishno Devi in Jammu and Kashmir, in the foothills of Himalayas, if we come up with a wellness center. So this wellness center is just not going to be used by the tourists that are coming or the pilgrims that are coming, but also by the locals. So major benefit of the local infrastructure building is that the government is also able to take care of the needs, wants and desires of the local people within that particular region. So, and if we have more localized infrastructures that, as we have been debating over a period of time for past few lectures also, and this is what I have put forward, that domestic tourism is going to be the first one to pick up. This is what I have been again and again stressing, and the religious tourism is going to be the next within the domestic tourism. So when you're talking about domestic tourism, you also want to see to it, we are primarily talking about a range of 120, 130, 150 kilometers, because as Dr. Puva gave an example of the van, now people are going to avoid community travel. Like they would not like to travel in buses or aeroplanes or trains, but they would more like to travel by own car. And you would like to have a site or a visit where you can go and come back by evening or spend at max one night over there. So these are the regions around you which are going to grow up. So local infrastructure is going to be very important for the growth of tourism, and it is also going to benefit the local people within that region. The next question is question number two. Dr. Puva, can you take that question number two?
Just one moment. I couldn't see the Okay. I couldn't see the screen, the shared screen.
Okay, now can you?
Okay, 1 minute. Let me.
So I'll just.
Can you, if you can just read the I don't know why suddenly.
What model is the sustainable development components based on? So what is the model
okay.
sustainable development components are directly, you also talked about it in your lecture also. So this is by the
direct. Okay.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. So if you see, as I mentioned, it's all pre-1980s, which was dominated by the Western paradigm. Western paradigm very much heavily influenced by the capitalism philosophy, meaning I work hard, I get lots of money, so what, right? That kind of belief, that kind of belief, right? So I wouldn't want to name a particular country or what, which is a strong believer of this particular paradigm. But slowly, end of 19, I showed in my slide earlier, even in 1972, in Stockholm, there was protest, okay, against certain countries, especially US, especially the United States of America, for being heavily on economic development, neglecting social, cultural, and environmental aspects. So the model was basically derived from the Western paradigm. That's a term, Western paradigm, towards green paradigm. Green paradigm introduced. So a combination of Western paradigm and green paradigm gave us sustainable tourism model with three dimension, which was established by Dr. Joe Brundtland in Brundtland Commission, United Nations, 1987. So it's if you are looking from a theoretical point of view, this model was from a policy point of view, from the policy from United Nations itself, the three dimensions of sustainable development. This was propagated heavily from 1987, United Nations, not UNWTO, United Nations.
Yeah. So I'll quickly take one more question. This is about future of mass tourism post COVID. So obviously, mass tourism is not going to be there. At least for next couple of years. As we are seeing, there are guidelines and protocols and new normals coming up. Government of India has also started coming up with few things. ICMR is coming up with few things, which is talking about the fact that avoid international travel, avoid long-range travel, avoid all these things. So mass tourism, we were talking about just before COVID, around about 8-9 months back, a new research or new form of research was picking up in last 1 or 2 years that was regarding over tourism. Everybody has been talking about over tourism and all those concepts and all those things. A lot of research was going on. I think over tourism is something which we are going to miss for a long time. As we saw when I think Dr. Rupam or Dr. Jitesh was talking about Barcelona and all those places where there were protests also regarding over tourism and people did not want tourists to come. In fact, in Leh Ladakh also, some of the places people didn't want many tourists to come and all those things. So mass tourism obviously is not going to be there in at least in the near future, 1 to 2 years. But since we human being per se are very resilient, and hospitality and tourism industry is one of the most resilient amongst them. So what I feel is that this is going to bounce back, but let's see, not in immediate future. At this moment, we would see most of the places operating at 20 to 23% or 40%. Over to you, Dr. Puva. Anything you want to add?
Just like what Prof. Parikshar has mentioned on mass tourism. It's nothing new. It's nothing new. But I remember asking a marketing head of a regional airline in a particular forum, why are you directing all the flights to a single destination? He said, we just follow the demand. Then I said, you are a cause of destruction. He said, sir, we cannot do anything. You are talking from sustainable point of view, but this is our money. So back to tourist gaze. We need to educate the tourists themselves. You know, there are so many destinations. Like I said, I mean, people from India, you know, thousands of destinations. I believe India has got the most cultural UNESCO heritage sites in the world. That's like about 40 plus, I remember reading, right? So why don't diversify all these destinations? Then you don't see over tourism issues, right?
You're right.
Thank you.
I think we should we'll close over here. Rest of the questions we'll post it to Poova, Dr. Poova also, and I'll also we'll have the answers for them on our website.